Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for this morning's sermon is the baptism of our Lord as recorded in Luke chapter 3, beginning at verse 21. When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven. You are my Son, whom I love. With you, I am well pleased. This is the word of the Lord given to us this morning. You may be seated. Dear friends in Christ Jesus, when you hear the word epiphany, what comes to mind? Most people, when they hear the word epiphany, they immediately think of the star, or they think of the Magi, which is what we discussed last week. Originally, when Christians heard the word epiphany, they immediately thought of the baptism of our Lord. Why would that be? Because our Lord's baptism is the great event that confirms the fact that the Christ child born in Bethlehem is God made manifest. Jesus, the second person of the Holy Trinity, the Son of God, and the Savior of the world, has come into the world to die for all mankind. He had come to die for each and every one of you. Therefore, when we see Jesus standing in the River Jordan with John the Baptist, there is one question that should come to mind. Why is Jesus in the Jordan? Now, I could ask a very startling question. Did Jesus really belong in the river? Did he really belong in the water? Or did he? John's baptism stands as a stark reminder that all people were under the judgment of God. There are no exceptions. Therefore, the people were coming out to be baptized of John. But still, the Jews believed, the Pharisees, the scribes, and the Sadducees believed, they didn't need baptism. It wasn't necessary. It wasn't really for the forgiveness of sins. Sound familiar? Modern day Pharisees still teach the very same thing. In John's baptism, Jesus was acting. God was acting. The Holy Spirit was active in showing their grace to all people. In Matthew chapter 3, which is another account of Jesus' baptism, we hear these words from our Lord. Let it be so now. It is proper for us to fulfill all righteousness. Also in John, we hear these words from the baptizer. And my friends, I have to warn you. When John said these words, it wasn't a whisper. He wasn't whispering it under his voice. He actually shouted it so that the people would hear, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." This is the grace of God coming into the world. John recognized who Jesus was, but still he resisted, as we hear from the book of Matthew. Then Jesus tells him, "This must be done to fulfill all righteousness." But you may ask, Jesus didn't need repentance of sins. Jesus didn't need forgiveness of sins. He was already righteous. He was already perfect. He was the sinless Son of God. So why did he insist on being in the River Jordan? My friends, you may have never thought of it this way, but if Jesus would have refused to walk into the water, you and I would have no hope. You see, by him fulfilling all righteousness, Jesus, as he walked into the River Jordan, took your sin and my sin upon himself. This was the beginning of Jesus' journey to Jerusalem, where eventually he would be nailed to a cross and die for the sins of the world, where he would die for your sins. So therefore, Jesus had to fulfill all righteousness. Jesus was in the River Jordan because that is where he belonged. He was there because we are sinners and we are under God's judgment, each and every one of us. There is no exceptions, including your pastor. Some people have this misgiving that pastors make no mistakes. You'll find out at 1 o'clock that I do make mistakes. We'll discuss one that I've made. You see, I'm also in need of forgiveness. Not only your forgiveness, but God's forgiveness. And therefore, you are under need of forgiveness. Not only mine and each other's, but God's forgiveness. So by Jesus being baptized for each and every one of us, Jesus identified himself with the people whom he came to save. And who were those people? Even the various Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the scribes who refused to be baptized. He even died for them. He died for you, even in those gross sins that you know you're committing. Even in the sins that I know that I'm committing, as heinous as they are. Jesus came to fulfill all righteousness so that you too can be saved. So that I too can be saved. The innocent Son of God walked into the River Jordan, and placed upon him was the guilt, the penalty of sin. And as Jesus finished his work in the water, we hear that righteousness was fulfilled, because then something marvelous happens. The heavens are opened as Jesus stands there praying. Hint, hint. Jesus standing there praying. You will hear all through the book of Luke as we go through the rest of the church year that Jesus had this great habit. He had this great form. He is always found in prayer. I pray that you are always found in prayer. Not only praying for yourself, but praying for the person sitting next to you, and behind you, and in front of you. And yes, even praying for your pastor, for I certainly need your prayers. Jesus is standing there praying, and suddenly, heaven is opened, and descending on him as a form of a dove is the Holy Spirit. And then we hear the voice from heaven. You see, Jesus is in the water, praying for us. He's praying for all mankind, for he knows what he is about to do and what he is about to be anointed to do. Jesus then receives the gift of the Holy Spirit. He is anointed by the Holy Spirit as he stands in the water. The descending dove and the heavenly voice are then the supreme verification. It's the stamp of approval, if you will, on all that Jesus is about to do and all that he came to do. My friends, as you also are well aware, as Jesus is standing in the water, the descent of the dove, the Holy Spirit, the voice from heaven, a clear reference to the Holy Trinity. It's undeniable. God the Son standing in the water, God the Holy Spirit descending upon him to anoint him for his work. And then the voice from heaven, God the Heavenly Father, speaking his words of approval. My friends, as the dove landed on our Lord. He was anointed to do his work. Just as a king or a prophet was anointed in the Old Testament, but they were anointed with oil. Our Lord was anointed with the Holy Spirit. He is now going on his royal way. Our king is going to leave the water. He's going to go into the land. He is going to heal various and many diseases. He is going to drive out demons. He's going to raise the dead. And then himself eventually would later die on his way to the cross. Jesus does all of this, not for himself. He does it for each and every one of us. As Jesus was being anointed by the Holy Spirit, the words of the Heavenly Father are so, so important. Many people have this habit of glossing over them. Oh, that's just the voice of God. Doesn't really mean anything, but you have to know if it's in the Bible, it means something, and it does. The Father begins by saying, "This is my beloved Son." Do you know that you find the same in Psalm chapter 2? It's a reference to the Anointed One, the Christos, the Christ. And by the way, Christos, Christ, is not Jesus' last name. It is his title. He is the Anointed One. He is the Messiah. He is your Savior. And that's what Christos, the Anointed One, means. And this is what happens in the River Jordan. Jesus is proclaimed the Christ, the Anointed One. God says from Psalm chapter 2, he says very clearly, "You are my Son." God approves of what his Son is about to do, and therefore he accepts his work. This is a description of the Messiah. This is the description of the mighty King, the mighty God who is to come, and now has come, and now has been anointed to do his work. Then God continues. He continues by saying, very clearly, "Whom I love, with you I am well pleased." Well, it would stand to reason that God would love his Son, but divine love is much different than the love that you have for someone. The divine love that God has for his Son, knowing that his Son is going to die, this is truly divine love, knowing that in his love for him, he would put his Son to death to appease his wrath. That's love, to send a Son to die for all mankind. Then he says, "In whom I am well pleased." Here Jesus, our suffering servant, standing in the water, is about to be enthroned. He is the King, the Messiah. But his throne is not in a palace. His throne is not a throne of gold or silver or bronze. His throne, my friends, is a cross, a bloody wooden hewn cross, and of which he was nailed to. No, he didn't sit on the throne. He was nailed to his throne. And in this, God was well pleased. This is certainly a description of your suffering servant. In Isaiah 42, we hear a clear description of Jesus as our suffering servant. Isaiah writes, "Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will bring justice to the nations." We see this happening here in the River Jordan. The suffering servant has now been anointed. The Spirit has been put upon him, and he is about to bring justice to all nations and to all peoples. So now, my friends, now you know why Jesus is in the water. Now you know why he went into the River Jordan. Now you know why he was there and what he was doing. He's in the water. He was in the water for each and every one of you. He was in the water because He loves each and every one of you. He was in the water so that each and every one of you can be saved. This is His great, unending love for all of us. And that's what Epiphany, is truly about. It's about the time in the church when we see the mighty acts of our Lord and His unending love for us. We see Jesus standing in the river, God made manifest, beginning His journey throughout all Judea and Galilee and eventually to Jerusalem. But His journey doesn't end at the cross. No, He saved you at the cross, but His journey will never end. Because, my friends, the tomb is empty. Our Lord ascended, and He will come again. Our anointed King, our suffering servant, will return as our great King and Lord to bring each of you into His kingdom, because He fulfilled all righteousness. Thanks be to Jesus that He went into the water. In the name of our Lord, amen. Please rise. The peace of God that surpasses all understanding guards your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.